Welcome, everybody. This is Manipulators Part 2. I'll explain why there are three parts in just a moment. You should be able to see my PowerPoint up on your screens. And this is just a little bit about me. I'm the head coach of Team 3023. We are Stark Industries. I can't take credit for coming up with that name. I kind of inherited it, and I'm grateful for it. We have a lot of fun with it. My first year was 2010 Breakaway. This is one of our favorite quotes because Iron Man's superpower is that he knows robotics, and we can all hope to be that someday. So why two parts? Well, the first part, if you were here with me last week, is game piece control. And I'm gonna do a little bit of that, go through some of the game pieces throughout the history of FIRST Robotics. Today we're doing part two, which is secondary tasks. These are arms, elevators, and lifts. And there's a lot of fun stuff going on in here. And then next week, I'm going to be doing part three, which is kickers, catapults, winches, and power, which is something I don't want to give anything away for next week. No, I don't want to give any spoilers. Okay, so this week, before we get going here, what exactly is a manipulator? And I want to open this up to the chat. What is the definition most FIRST Robotics students use for the manipulator? If you could answer in the chat, non-serious answers only, if you could. The craziest, funniest, weirdest things that you've heard students refer to, the parts of the robot that are in the general category of manipulators. So type those in the chat, and we will be talking through some of these. Thrower thingy, yes, excellent. My experience, and please continue to type them into the chat, my experience when I've asked students will say, I don't want to steal all your thunder here. Thing that does the thing, exactly, yes. I've had students do this, not the drivetrain, which they were right. And early on in the design process, it's not the drivetrain. That's the thing you're talking about. The mover thing, that's a good one. And then usually somebody who watches too much Monty Python starts chiming in whenever people start shouting stuff out. Very small rocks. Now, on my team, at least, they get this face from me simply because they get to go through this manipulator presentation with me, so they're all aware of what's going on. Now, the actual definition of a manipulator is a device that moves the game piece into the robot, out of the robot, moves it within the robot. That's what we're talking about here. I would recommend to prevent your team from calling it the thingy that does the thingy to the other thing. It's best to come up with a name early on. Come up with fun names. I mean, it gets kind of long and wordy sometimes, but if you just give it a name, people start to figure it out, and it works pretty well. So the question you have to ask is this. When I first started doing these presentations, it was the first and the most important question is, and I realize it's not the most important question, they're like equally important. What are you trying to manipulate? And then this, I'm going to go through a very quick survey, I guess, of all the game pieces that FIRST has had. And I built this presentation years ago, partly because I just wanted to geek out on all the different game pieces. But this year, if you haven't watched the teasers and you have no idea what I'm talking about, this year, I'm very excited about all of these game pieces because they're hinting at bringing back anything and everything. I will say this. The 6-inch diameter water-filled ball was a game piece back in 1993. Arguably, that was a water challenge because there was water on the field. I had students that insist that there was that ball was part of the teaser videos that we've seen so far. So you'll see there's a lot of spherical objects, a lot of balls on the field. There's a lot of things like that. Also, keep an eye on these different parts, the ones that have reoccurring themes. You can see the 24-inch diameter ball has already on the screen twice in very short succession. There's going to be a question after I go through the entire survey asking how many pieces show up and when they showed up. So now we get to 98, 99, 2000. We start to see some items repeating. 1999 Double Trouble, that was the year of the floppy. And if you watch the videos, you've seen that they had this very prominently displayed in the first and the second video, which The reason why the photo for this one is so low quality and the rest of the photos for all the other game pieces are, you know, nice and crisp is I could not find photos of this floppy. This one I had to take out of a video because it seems like people tried to forget it. I'm not sure if First is going to try to do a redemption story with the floppy or not, but I'm excited to see what they do with that one. Now we have Frenzy, First Frenzy. 2005 was pretty awesome. The tetrahedrals, that was really cool. I really hope to bring those back. We have some squishies. We have some giant exercise balls. We have the inner tubes coming back. 2009 Lunacy, that was a weird one. One of the outliers. And it's called like, there's a moon rock and a power cell and a fuel cell and an empty cell, bunch of different stuff. Takeaway, this is my first year coaching 2010. And we had inner tubes, squish balls, frisbees. That was a lot of fun. And the totes. Okay, now getting into ones that are more common for a lot of people. We have 10-inch squishy, the boulder. Steamworks was pretty impressive on a lot of different levels just because first time we had human players on the field and the only time we've had since then, and two new outlier game pieces, gear, which I still love the gear, and the fuel cell. Then we had cube, box, hatch, all these things. And now it's time for your question. You're going to vote using the annotation. So at the top of your screen, you should see annotation with a little pencil mark. If you click on that, you'll be able to see stamps. And I'd like you to try to vote by placing a stamp in the table that you see up on your screen. What was the highest number of appearances by any one game piece? Oh, I'm sorry, Levi can't answer. He says five. Levi says five. Also, chat question. What game piece had the most appearances? And you can see on the bottom that I teach high school because you can't just shout out the spherical one. That doesn't quite count. Specifically, which game piece had the most appearances? Type what you think the game piece was in the chat. Vote for the number up on the screen. Okay, we got six, five. Somebody's trying to do 5.5. 24-inch ball, 24-inch diameter ball. Okay, good call. Probably seven. Oh, okay. Somebody's saying seven appearances. This is okay. We got a couple votes for seven. Exercise ball, we will take that. The 24-inch diameter ball. This one, six. Okay. If you haven't had a chance to vote, try to get it done quick. There is a heart on the far left. I'm not sure if that's a vote for two or something like that. Reoccurring game pieces, the correct answer is five. Five is the largest number of appearances any one game piece has ever had. And there are two game pieces that share this title. The 13-inch diameter kind of squishy ball, similar to what we had a couple of years ago, the giant orange ones, and the 24-inch diameter exercise ball. These two have made five appearances. The years they appeared are up on screen. Coming in with four is the squishy. And I included the 7-inch squishy and the 10-inch squishy. I kind of put those together. Then we have soccer. Soccer ball came up three times. And then we have the 3-inch diameter now. Some people will say that the 30-inch and the 24-inch are the same thing. If you do slam those together, you do come up with a whopping seven. Okay. Now, outliers. Outliers, we got some fun ones here. Tennis balls. I really honestly want them to bring back the tennis balls. I think that'd be a lot of fun if they could do that. We also have the double treble, the floppies in 1999. I'm just trying to get my annotation. Okay, here we go. Tetrahedrals, Lunacy, some of the fun ones here that we've had in the past. And who knows? I mean, some of these might come back. I kind of want tennis balls to come back. I love frisbees. Those are fun. Now that you know what to manipulate, you need to ask yourself, what do you want to do with it, okay? And now this is where two, we're going to be focusing on arms, elevators, and lifts. Question? Okay, cool. So we're going to be spending most of our time on the hold, the transfer. Arms, elevators, and lifts. We're going to do arms first. Alphabetically, I guess? Okay. General guidelines, no matter what you're building, try to make lightweight. Most of us are doing aluminum for lots of reasons. Thin wall if you can. designing sensors for feedback. A lot of times, first time they test something, they will rip the robot apart, or the arm will flip over and break stuff. And if you don't have any sort of limit switches or sensors to create some sort of a stopping mechanism, it can be pretty bad. Also, keep it simple. Keep it as simple as possible. The fewer parts to build, the fewer parts to break, it's easier to operate. All of these things is kind of general rule. Everybody does this about first. One other thing that people don't necessarily consider is this. You get very focused on motors, and you should. But sometimes we forget that you can have counterbalance with either weight or bungees or springs, some sort of mechanical advantage of some sort that will just help your motors not have to take on the entire burden themselves. You just to prevent blowout. And there's a couple other things here, springs, weights. Okay, on the corner it does say this. We were able to use this quite successfully 1 year. Your motor can work as an excellent counterweight if you have a pivot system. We did this during Steamworks. We had a mechanism for the climbing where we had our motor was our counterweight, and it worked really well. But this question, true or false? Now for this one, you're gonna wanna go to your reactions, which for you might be on the bottom of your screen. For me, it's on the top of my screen. But you're gonna wanna go to your reactions. You should see what you see up on screen. And I'd like you to please vote using the green check mark for true and the red X for what are you talking about? The question is it a good idea to use your battery as a counterweight on your arm? Okay, we're seeing a lot of people say, no, why would you do that? Yeah. So I put this on there for a team that is near and dear to 3023. They once had they used their battery as a counterweight on their arm, their lifting mechanism. And like lots of things, it worked until it didn't. And their battery went flying across the field one time. What we did learn that day was that a robot can travel quite a distance even after the battery has flown in the other direction. It was quite the sight to see and very impressive. We all were shocked by how much, it was really good. Okay, now the question is this. What type of arm? If you've never been to a manipulator presentation or seen any, you know that the answer to almost all of my questions are, well, it depends, and you have options. There are three options, I would argue, for types of arms. There's fixed arms, parallel arms, and pointed arms. I'm gonna try to get through all of these as quick as we can so we can get to lifts and elevators. So, fixed arms. Fixed arms are pretty straightforward, very simple. You have some sort of pivoting.
Hey, Mark, I'm sorry to interrupt for just a second. Audio is getting a little garbled. It's getting hard to hear you.
I'm sorry. Okay. Is that better?
That is better. Thank you.
Okay. I will try to stay closer to my microphone. Sorry about that.
No, thank you for moving forward.
No, yeah. So fixed arms are very simple. There's a pivot mechanism, motor, pneumatics, whatever you got. I do have this picture up there because the robot that you see, the picture on the right, that is from the field guide. The videos that they put out on YouTube after the video challenge has been released, after the game has been announced. And what you see there was the ramps that year could handle two full batteries at 28 inches away from their center. And a lot of teams didn't watch those videos and didn't realize how much force they needed. So that's just something you gotta watch the field guide videos. Okay, fixed arms. Usually what you're doing is some sort of power maneuver. You're applying a lot of force. And what a lot of teams don't necessarily think about or do the calculations for is when you're doing a torque calculation like this, you really have to ask yourself and take into consideration how far is the arm going to be away from the point of rotation? When is the arm going to be applying force? Because you can see from the picture on your screen that when the arm is at its farthest point away from its pivot, you have a distance that's twice the distance as when it is in a raised position. And if you look at the calculations below, you'll see that the situation is you need twice as much torque as you do when it is in the up position. And, you know, sometimes this doesn't matter at all because teams just build very powerful, very robust arms. But the problem is we're always short on weight. We're always trying to cut weight wherever we can. And you really need to think about and do the calculations and figure out what is the change in force going to be as the arm pivots and moves. So just something to consider. Pointed arms, okay. Pointed arms are fascinating. This is one, I think this is one from Wildstang. This arm appeared in a video produced with one of the guys, Grant Imahara from Mythbusters, did a video showing about design with this. Jointed arms, obviously, they have a shoulder, they have an elbow, they have a wrist. There's a lot going on in these, and this is something teams will tackle after they've built several arms and done a few things here. What you need to remember when you're working with jointed arms is that every joint, you're adding lots of complexity, but you're also adding a lot of weight. So that, you know, your shoulder has to be able to handle like the bearings, the strength, it has to be able to pivot and rotate, and has to be able to hold a lot of weight in a lot of different angles. The other thing is we often will calculate the in piece that the object is lifting, but we sometimes forget just the weight of the arm itself and how much force is needed just to hold up those motors, everything that's going on there. And you really got to think through those situations. At the end of this PowerPoint, there's a link to a website that will help you walk through those calculations, and you put in your lengths and your distances and the mass of this and that and the other, and it pops out forces that are needed. It's kind of nice that way. Generally, the advice I've been given by engineers, my father, is figure out how much force you need and then double it. That's rarely served us poorly. We always do pretty well with that one. Okay, so next up, parallel arms. Parallel arms, it's also known as a four-bar linkage. These can be pretty nice in certain circumstances, and we'll have you guys vote on which one you like the best in a moment. But a parallel arm does exactly what you see here. It's kind of like a simple fixed arm, except with the added benefit that it does this. It's really nice because it will keep the game piece in the same orientation that you have it. Things you need to watch out for, though, there is a lot of force on the pins. There's just a ton of shearing force that's going on. You can get a lot of buckling at the lower levels, and you have to be careful with the center of gravity. Some of the benefits, though, it keeps the game piece in the same orientation. And this was really, really nice when you have a situation where you pick up the game piece, then you don't have to build a wrist to pivot game piece. You can just pick it up, use your parallel linkage system, and then put it where it goes. It's also relatively simple to build as long as you build it strong. Make sure you have nice pins in there. It does have limited rotation, and height can be an issue. That's always something you need to think about. But this one, though, what's better than a parallel arm? Parallel arms. This is beautiful. I love that they just went all in on this and they built. I feel like, is this like an 8-bar linkage? I mean, that is sweet. That is brilliant. That is extremely well done. So, which one is your favorite? Which one we're going to vote by stamps again? Also, feel free to put your reasoning, your, this is probably too strong of a word here, but like, why did you vote the way that you did? Parallel. Simple fixed arm and a jointed arm. Which one do you think is the best? Vote by putting stamps, hearts, check marks. I don't know if we have horseshoes or the full-on Lucky Charms arrangement of stamps, but that's something Zoom should probably get. So tell me which one's your favorite. Good, yeah. Fixed, nice, okay. Okay. Got some people voting for some of the jointed arms. That's good. I think parallel is winning right now. I like the parallel just because it's kind of pretty. It looks nice. I think actually, there we go. Okay. I like the trail alarm. It looks nice. The jointed arm it's a lot to bite off. It is. It's a lot of work. It's got to be done quite nicely in order for this thing to work effectively. But if you have a team that really dedicated, if you've done some of the other ones. Okay, yeah. Oh yeah, somebody pointed out they like the parallel arm, both sides support each other, but they have to be aligned. That's true. That's a good point. Yeah. Yeah. I'd say fixed arm probably wins the award for simple, which is always nice. Okay. So we're on to lifts. All right. So lifts. There's a lot of times in first where either you need to lift your robot up, need to hang, or you need to lift the mechanism. They almost always give us a height requirement that is ridiculously low compared to what we have to do with our robot. So, lifts. All right. There are a couple of different kinds, like is always the case. And we have a situation here with extension lifts. That's what we're going to be talking about quite a bit here. There's a lot going on with that. And then what we have, scissor lifts. We'll be talking about that. And, okay, here we go. Extension lift guidelines. You need to have a drive cable both for the up and the down. There's a temptation to just let gravity bring your lift back down, and I understand. But as soon as you rely on that, it's not. These things get beat up a little bit. Once your lift has gone up, if it gets just knocked just a little bit, gravity's not going to be able to have enough to pull it back down. You really want to be able to have it driven down as well as up. Also, sometimes just for time, you really need that. The minimum overlap of your segments, no matter what you're doing, should be 20%. And that is, I say this a couple of times, is a minimum. That's not the maximum, that is the minimum. Teams are always tempted to kind of shortchange this one, and I completely understand. It's very, very tempting if you just need a little bit more. Honestly, though, it just gets dangerous. The thing's more likely to break down and fall apart. This is what a extension lift looks like in, you know, a gift file. This one, I'll show you about the different cabling systems that are available and the different options of how to make it go up and down in just a moment. Things you have to consider, power versus speed. Don't underestimate the power needed. The weight of a lift can be a lot. Also, the weight of the game pieces, while it seems insignificant, it can be a lot, especially once you get some mechanisms on there. The calculations after the game piece, of course. Lifts, you don't ever want to have your motor holding the weight of the lift if you can avoid it. Now, if you have a light lift, it's not as big of a deal, but in some cases it becomes problematic. The other situation that you need to consider is, so there are times in first, we're always tempted to try to make anything do as much as it can. If you can use the same mechanism as your intake and your scoring mechanism, that's awesome, you should do it. The problem is there are teams that will, if your elevator is going up and down to score game pieces, great, it needs to be fast. If you want to use the same elevator mechanism to grab on and lift your robot, then it needs to be powerful. And in the third presentation that I'll give to you guys, you'll see that you literally can't have both. And that is something that we always struggle with. This is where it gets extensive. Okay. So, extension regulars, there's continuous and cascading, and then continuous has external and internal. And all of these have benefits and drawbacks. We're going to talk about these and vote on which one you guys like towards the end. In general, this is what we have. We have continuous. Continuous, you see that orange colored cable that literally strings through the entire part. So, the cable that is connected to the motor that is being pulled in to your drum, that is what is connected to the part of your robot that is holding on to the game piece. That's the word continuous. Cascading, you have a different effect. Cascading, you can see, and I'll get into this more as I go through this, but right now, having not seen my slides on continuous versus cascading, I am curious. And I just decided to throw this up as a challenge. So the statement is, continuous is better than cascade. I'd like you to vote by agreeing with a green check mark and disagree with a red X.
And Mark, while they're thinking about that, you had a question in the chat whether you'd be willing to share the PowerPoint to help them throughout their season.
Definitely, definitely. I have this PowerPoint, I have updated it and I haven't published the updated version yet. I have the, it is on my team's website. And at the end, I have a link to the team's website where you can see last year's version of this PowerPoint. And I will have that updated before this coming, the jumpstart in St. Cloud on December 4th. I will have them updated by then on the website. And I'll have, I'll post the link to the website on screen. But thank you, that's a good question. The video of this will be uploaded to Jumpstart's website by, I think, I don't want to put pressure, but I think they, like in a week, this video will be published there. So you get to hear all my fun talking stuff. Okay, we do have some people who are willing to say that continuous is better than cascade. Thank you for being willing to be contrarian to the society and to the general votes that we're getting on screen here. But yeah, this is continuous. As I said, the orange cable that you see, it starts off down here and it's all going through the entire mechanism. And there are the benefits of this. It's really nice that you have the same speed for the up cable as the down cable. You can see the down cable is, and it's kind of weird because it's almost flip-flop, but when you thread the orange cable in, it goes up, so it's the up cable, the down cable, the yellow cable. It works really nice because they can be on the same drum, so that as one spools in, you can spool the other one out, and you can control it nicely with one motor, goes up, goes down, life's pretty good. The downside, though, is intermediate sections jam. I don't say sometimes, it says sometimes on the PowerPoint, it will jam because there is an insanely large amount of tension going on, especially in that middle section. You have all the forces. I mean, like whenever you have a chain, whenever you have a belt, whenever you have some drive system, if you're turning a corner, you're asking your forces to like flip around, and that puts massive pressure. And when the actual pulling force is so far away from the motors, it just gets to be really, really difficult. And the pressure on the middle intermediate carriage just gets to be insane. And for that, that's why a lot of teams shy away from this. The other problem is there's more complexity of the cabling, and that alone can cause issues, jamming. So this is a video that it looks like once stage one hits, then stage two goes up. And that's more or less how it goes. This is just a simple two stage one with a GIF file to help you see what's going on here. Additionally though, this does create like, that's a lot of force. If you see that first one, it has to like hit the gear or hit the mechanism and lock it in place. And then the force lifts up to the next stage. That creates, it's a lot of forces, a lot of smashing together. So what's the other option? This, okay. Sorry, I forgot, it gets worse. This is continuous internal rigging. Now, if you are a team that feels like, I mean, the problem with this is the yellow cable is kind of exposed and out in the open. So there are teams that choose to do continuous internal rigging. Exact same as continuous rigging. It's just that the return cable also threads its way through the robot. And this can be a disaster. It does protect the cables though. That's nice. It does have a kind of cool look that way. However, the chances, the added friction, the added tension, you're gonna have some problems. We've built a couple of different cascade riggings. I find them just simpler. Okay, they're everything. They're simpler in some ways and more complicated in other ways. They're simpler in terms of the forces, but what you can see here in the image is that the motor pulls in on that orange cable, that first cable, and it causes the middle section to rise. And because the green bar right here, it's connected to the top of that first stage. So as the intermediate section rises, and you'll see a GIF file in a moment of this, as that middle stage, the stage one rises, because the green cable is connected to the top of the base, then the green cable is also connected to the bottom of stage two, so it rises up. And this, I like it just because it lowers the tensions and the frictions on it. The downside, though, is there is much, much more force on the lower stage. And the other problem is you can't use the same drum for the unspooling and the spooling in of the cable or the belt. So, you know, with each of these, there's a lot of differences. This one has a traveler in the center, and the traveler naturally flows up and down with the carriages, and you can set it up pretty easily to have it up and down control inside your carriage flow system. This one is, it's a simple one, it's just got a one stage. A lot of times, if you can get away with this, I would recommend it. You can get a lot of height out of these based on the different challenges and how high you're going with your robot. And it's basically just the same thing, only it's one level instead of two. So, question for you though, what do you think is better? Elevators or arms? If you had to choose, you had to pick one or the other, which one do you go with? Both using stamps, and as always, feel free to explain your arguments in the chat. I feel like, yeah, this is hard. This is hard. Somewhat personal preference, but also. Also, the bot on the right, it does not specifically say which game that one's designed for, but you can also put that. Somebody posted, they're like, aligning the elevators bites. So true. That's true. Arms are more versatile. I think there's probably some truth in that. Yeah. I think the counter would be sometimes arms usually can only get you so high. With a double stage on an elevator, you can get to higher heights. But it's true. Arms are more versatile. Blinding elevators can be, it can be frustrating. More fun to watch an arm climb. There's truth to that. It's also more terrifying to watch things not go so well. But yeah, you're right. Anybody have a guess on what they think the bot on the right, what game that was designed for? Because I just looked at that and I'm like, I don't even know. Keep posting that because I want to hear your thoughts on that one. My answer to this is why choose? I know some of you are like, because that's stupid. You just got done saying there's problems with both. That's true. I would say our team, for our part, generally, if we're in a situation where we have to add a second stage to get a height, a reach, we will often contemplate this type of design, where you mount an arm onto your elevator. And some people, that sounds horrible and just like a headache and a disaster. And I get it. I do see the point of that. There have been teams, this is a design that has been used in the past with great success. This is an arm on an elevator. This team built this in such a way that it allowed them to have a very nice functional arm and get some good reach out of that. And then they just mounted that up and down as a carriage on a single stage elevator. And in doing so, you can get a lot of height, a lot of versatility. And it works pretty well in a lot of ways. Now, this is a scissor lift. I'm not a fan of scissor lifts. I will say this, though. Last year, what I'm doing here, this one is, the advantage of a scissors lift is you can make it really small. It can get to a really low height. It can get very short and go under barriers, which is nice. Disadvantages are, tend to be, if you want to make it stable, it's usually heavy. It doesn't deal well with side loads. And full disclaimer, this is a quote from Andy Baker from a PowerPoint slide that I stole from him. And I went through this part, and last year I didn't know, but Andy was in the audience watching, and he asked a question afterward, and I was a bit terrified that he did not agree with what I had said that he said, but luckily it worked out pretty well. Okay, this is a good one. Somebody posted in the chat, they said, in addition to what I listed above is scissor lifts tend to take up a lot of space in the robot, and that's true, they do. And they tend to be really heavy and bulky a lot. Also, they need to be, it says in there, they need to be machined perfectly. In addition to that, one of the issues is the initial forces needed to pull on a scissor lift to get the force up that you need, they're insane. They're crazy high. Usually the people are using screws and pulling on that, and it's, oh my goodness. If you do the calculations on these things, it is insane. It is insane how much force you need to get that thing started. Okay. So, scissor lifts, in general, I tend to not try to vote one way or another on any of these things. Also, if you try to pin me down on what was the best, I will squirm out of that as much as I possibly can. And it's not because I don't have opinions. Most people who know me would know that's a lie. It's that all of these are really great for very specific challenges. This is one of the few ones where I'm not a fitness specialist, but at the same time, in the hub that I'm a part of, the Central Minnesota Robotics Hub, there are several teams that are really, really good at building scissor lifts, and they've done very well with them, and they've gone very far with them. One team even used a scissor lift to lift their robot, which I didn't think that was a doable option until they did it. And so that was honestly very impressive. Okay, so when you're trying to figure out what you need to do, you need to look around, you need to figure out, okay, what's available, what have teams done in the past? I go through all the list of the game pieces in the past of FIRST Robotics because you need to see what was done. If we had the same game piece, if we had the same challenge-ish 5 years ago, 10 years ago, you need to go figure out what other people did. The problem has already been solved. Did they solve it well? Figure out what's going on. Know your design objective and know your game strategy. A lot of us struggle with this. My team, I struggle with this, we struggle with this. And we have people who are in charge of just repeating the strategy. Just like out of nowhere, apropos of nothing, they're like, you know, the whole point of what we're doing here is we're trying to do this. And it's helpful to reorient yourself because if you're trying to build a bot that's really, really fast, but you're spending all of your build time on the end game mechanism, and that's not your strategy, you need to like rethink that. Also, flipping over, if your strategy is all about the end game, that's where you need to focus all your time and energy, and that's where you need to dedicate your robot space, battery allotment, energy, all of those things. Stay within your capacity and your capabilities as far as design. My team, we're rebuilding this year. A lot of teams are rebuilding this year. And if they want to build a jointed arm, they're going to have to show that's outside of our capabilities this year. We that level is complicated, and it's not something that I think our team would be able to succeed well at. So understand dimensions. If you don't model in CAD, try to find somebody who can or will help you with this to get the real idea of the forces that are going on and all that's happening there. You need to be able to see the dimensions. You need to be able to see the rotations, the pivots. CAD has a lot of great stuff. There's a lot of software free for us. Keep it simple and make it well. We had a design that was, we loved it. It was a great design. We did not execute it well. And because of that, it cost us a lot. It was a very, very frustrating situation. And build team and the design team, they're about ready to rip parts off the robot and chuck them. And a mentor from another team came over and admired the design and told the design team that's brilliant, I love it. And one of the kids like, yeah, it doesn't work. And the mentor, being a classic FIRST Robotics mentor, he's like, oh, you didn't build it well at all, but it's a beautiful design. And we took it as the compliment that it was, but it really was a lesson to us to really always make sure craftsmanship can ruin the best design. It doesn't matter how brilliant your design is. If you do it badly, it's not gonna work. I did have one kid years ago. The running joke with him was, it was 2011. It was the year that we had to build a mini bot that would deploy from our robot and then fly basically straight up a 10-foot pole. And we redesigned that mini bot like, oh, good night, 10, 15 times. And that became the running joke with that crew, like redesign. And we would, and I know that is scary and terrifying, or can be, to kind of start over. However, your first design, your first decision, your first idea is probably your worst, because any design, any idea that comes after that is going to be better because it's going to include all the concepts from that first one. So always try to redefine. We have time now for a lot of questions at the end. So if you have a question that you're thinking about, type it into the chat. If there's something I missed because I ran through the elevators and the lifts and everything way too fast, type something in the chat. I do want to give some credits where credit is due while you guys are thinking through those questions and getting them ready and typed up. But a lot of this PowerPoint originally was taken from Bruce Whitfield from Team 2471. He did a lot of stuff with these things, and he is the starting material that I used when I started working with Bruce, from what I gathered and learned, borrowed a lot from some PowerPoints that Andy Baker made years before. And I also discovered it was like archaeological layers. It was like going back in time to first robotics. I need to give a shout out to Greg Needle from Teams 131 and 1511. And I don't know, for all I know, these slides do go all the way back to Dean Kamen himself. These are the links, and I will post this. I borrowed heavily Team 254. They build a lot of great stuff. Cheesy Poofs, good stuff. And then Team 358, if you've not been to their website, they have a lot of really good training materials and a lot of really good basics, some of the older stuff from first. And then this is my team's website, is www.team3023.org. I'll be posting all the information for the manipulator presentations there. And now if you have questions, I can go back to the slide that talks about that. If you want to know more about elevators or lifts or the arms, we can talk about all that. But it's free and open up either with your microphone or typing in the chat. Oh, okay.
Looks like you have a raised hand too.
Okay, cool. Go for it.
Hey, Mark. I just wanted to emphasize what you mentioned about actual manufacturing of your design. You know, all the things that we talked about, particularly four bar and the elevators, they really require very, very accurate hole drilling, placement of bearings, very square configurations, you know, things that are supposed to be at 90 degrees need to be at 90 degrees. Things that are supposed to be parallel have to be parallel. Yeah. And if that doesn't happen, the stresses go up exponentially in what you're trying to build. So.
Yeah, I agree. Thank you for putting that in there. And the other, like, we often try to do it. There's always that tension and that balance between weight, but it has to be robust enough. And a lot of times you need to have a lot of materials around it and a lot of holders. We've had pretty good success with the issues, those V bearings. Those can be frustrating. And they just don't have a lot of grip on them. We switched over to a full wheel mechanism that hooks into our, we use a lot of 80-20 extrusion. And so the wheels ride right in the wheels. We've had a lot of success with that, but you're right. It's a lot of rust. There's a question in the chat.
Alex asked a question. I'm so sorry. Can we do it in like 30 seconds as we got to back in the other room?
What would you consider to be the most difficult piece you've had to figure out how to deal with? Oh man, wow. Personally, my seeing frisbees was a lot. It was a lot of fun. Yeah, the hatch mechanism, that was hard. We didn't have to do the toroid, but we, yeah. I think that was one. Okay.
Sorry, friends, we have to bounce over to the other room. It is 4:50, we ran out of time, but thank you for asking questions and engaging with the Oh my gosh, it's the end of the day. What are they? Annotations. There we go.
Yeah.
I put the link to the main session, the closeout session, in the chat. Anybody wants to hold up for 30 seconds to get a last answer to this last question, give them a farewell answer there, Mark, do you think?
Yeah, there's one. Rebuilding any design in the box. Andy Mark just announced they have like a lifting mechanism. If you have enough money, you can just buy a lot of these things from Lex and Andy Mark and other places that have them. Those are available if you got the money. If you have other questions, feel free to email me. It's mark.durand@isd728.org. It's up on screen. Otherwise, thank you for listening. Thank you for participating. And maybe I'll see you next week.